Welcome to our Good Morning Mississauga. I am Joanne and I am going to be one of the MCs this morning. It is my pleasure. I am with World Financial Group and I will pass it over to Keith.
Well, thank you. Everybody hear me okay?
Yes.
My name is Keith Ferroy and I'm co-ambassador today with MC story today with Joanne, and my company is MJ Campbell Movers. We do residential household moves as well as commercial office moves. We do it here locally and we do it right across Canada, actually into the USA and even internationally in and out of Canada. Okay, I would like to now call upon Trevor McPherson, president of Mississauga Board of Trade, to say a few words.
Thank you, Keith. And what a beautiful morning it is here. I mean, we have to all dig out our sunglasses, but it's a sign, I think, of things to come. And thank you very much to the Port Credit Yacht Club here for hosting us this morning. I think when I think about International Women's Day, and you know, after thinking about my two daughters and their future, I think about how lucky Mississauga is in terms of female leadership, demonstrated, of course, first by the late Mayor Hazel McCallion and the legacy she has left us. And not only that, you know, we have a third term mayor and Mayor Crombie is continuing that leadership legacy. We have a fire chief, Darren Rizzi, who in 2022 was recognized as one of Canada's most powerful women. We have leaders across the business community. I was with some of them last night at Queen's Park for a life sciences reception. Leaders like Kirsten Combs at AstraZeneca, who just announced their additional 500 new jobs at AstraZeneca with the Prime Minister and the Premier and the Mayor, and many other politicians there. We have Ivy Parks out at BD and Brigitte Nollet at Roche. And it's not just the large companies, it's companies like the Little Rose Cookie Company in Streetsville that Stephanie Orlando founded and proudly calls herself the founder and CEO if you visit her website. So I think we have a lot to build on. In Mississauga, I'm also reminded of the progress that has been made. My colleague Claudia DeSanti at the Ontario Chamber of Commerce penned what she called a She-Covery Project report. So after the OCC penned their She-Session report, and make no mistake, the pandemic disproportionately impacted women and women, diverse women particularly as well. It's an area that we need to continue to pay our attention to and to do all that we can to ensure that, of course, access to opportunity, not enough, but equity is also part of the objective. And if we look at the numbers, in 76, 25% of household income was brought by the female in the household. In 2019, that's risen to 42%. But still, you know, we still are looking at a very discouraging number when it comes to female leadership on boards across corporate Canada, about 20%, which has been sitting at more or less that level for far too long. So I think more needs to be done on the equity and the pay equity side. Women, for every dollar that their male counterparts make, women are still making just 89 cents of that. So we need to continue to pay attention to that and do all that we can do, you know, when it comes to providing those opportunities and as I say, particularly with those that are from diverse communities, Indigenous communities, the disabled community as well, where there's great opportunity, not just because it's a good thing to do, because it makes good business sense and it's proven to be good business. So with that, thank you all for coming out. We are just so thrilled when you know, when I arrived and it was difficult to find a parking spot. That's amazing. And with that, I'll hand it back to Guy. Thank you, Guy.
Good morning, and from Meridian Credit Union as well, happy International Women's Day. It's a very, very special day, and like Trevor was just saying, it should be every day. Okay.
Yeah.
So I think we're very, very lucky to live in this environment in Canada where women rights are celebrated, we're empowered, and we can do our best. We can come out, do our best, and reach new heights and give to the community and to the economy. So Meridian Credit Union, it's a women-led business. Our CEO is a female, and she joined us last year in January. And we have a lot of supportive housing, indigenous businesses, and female-led businesses supporting programs. So as an affinity program sponsor, we offer the package. It's a banking package for members of Mississauga Board of Trade. Please come see me, let's discuss it, let's see how we can help you. And today, please enjoy your day, network, and again, happy International Women's Day.
Thank you, Nona, for joining us today and for being our GMM series sponsor. And now we would like to call up Tina Capobianco, Senior Vice President with JD Factors Corporation, to say a few words, and she will also welcome our special guest.
Thank you very much to the Mississauga Board of Trade for another great breakfast and Port Credit Yacht Club. Happy International Women's Day. So JD Factors has been in the Mississauga community for the last over 30 years. And I've been a part of that since, well, I'm not going to say, because it's been way too long. But in alternative finance, it's a very male-dominated industry. So over the years, it's always been evident that women really need to push through the ceiling. They need to prove themselves a little more. Some of us, when we decide to have children, always feel that guilt. And it's amazing that in 2023, we're finally at a stage now where women are recognized as true contributors to workforce, family life, and communities all over. So I'm very, very proud to be a part of this event and to be a woman in 2023. So GD Factors, a little bit about us. We're a factoring company. That means we purchase accounts receivables for small, medium-sized businesses. So it's an asset sale. There's no compromise to your balance sheet. Our JD Factors difference is that we're non-recourse, so we credit guarantee everything we purchase. So literally, you sell us your invoice and you can sleep well at night because it never comes back to you. And we also try and foster good, healthy business tactics and practices with our clients. So, enough about me and JD Factors. I am pleased this morning to introduce our speaker, a very well-respected woman in our community. Hope I say this right. Natalia Kusendova. All right. So on July 10th, 2018, Natalia took the oath of office and became the first MPP of the newly formed Mississauga Centre riding in Ontario. Natalia thanks the residents of Mississauga Centre for returning her to the Ontario Legislature to represent them for another term. MPP Natalia holds a Bachelor of Science degrees in Human and Molecular Biology, wow, from the University of Toronto, and in Nursing from Nipissing University. In addition, she speaks five languages, English, Polish, French, Czech, and Slovak. Well, that's quite an accomplishment. MPP Natalia is a registered nurse who has worked on the front line of our healthcare system, at the Etobicoke General Hospital in the Emergency Department, as well as the Vanier Centre for Women, Ontario's only female preventional correctional facility. MPP Natalia also served as a policy and political action executive network officer for the Registered Nurses Association of Ontario, Peel Chapter, and a member of the Canadian-Polish Congress National Executive Board. Natalia is passionate about her community and is ready to continue to work hard for the people of Mississauga Centre as well as all of Ontario. Please welcome Natalia.
Thank you so much and good morning, everyone. It's a beautiful, sunny day, and aren't we so lucky to live in such a beautiful country with such beautiful landscapes? So I was driving this morning and sort of reflecting about what message do I want to give you this morning for International Women's Day. And I actually called my mom to ask her, Mom, what is it about being a woman? What do you think is important? What message should I bring? And you know, my mom reflected on important issues, on issues like motherhood. Being a mom is, I think, innate to the feminine and to women's condition. And playing many different roles in society. We as women wear so many hats. And we're so good at it too, right? We're so good at multitasking. Not only are we mothers, wives, caregivers, we're also politicians, business leaders, scientists, trailblazers, athletes, etc. And so I think recognizing that very special role of women in society is very important. And I'm pleased to be here today to celebrate and honor our fellow women on this unforgettable day. Before I begin, I'd like to thank everyone who took the time to set up this fantastic event this morning. The Mississauga Board of Trade, all their staff and volunteers, please give them a huge round of applause. And today is really about honoring women's achievements and women's equality, which has been hard fought for. However, today is also a day we continue raising awareness and deem and work for more equality. We are here to educate and call upon everyone to continue the positive changes in advancing and bettering the next generation of women's rights. And as women, we understand that this has not been our first struggle. And actually, the history of Women's Day comes from 1909, where in New York, women were getting together to really fight for the right to vote. And that's how they established Women's Day. And here in Canada, it wasn't until 1918 that women received the right to vote, and they were deemed as persons. And that's famously called Persons Day, because on that day, women were deemed as persons and received the right to vote. However, we also know that at that time, not all women received the right to vote. Racialized women were excluded, and it took a lot longer to achieve equal rights for all women, including racialized women. And maybe I'll share a little bit about my story, because it is a woman's story. And I think it's a story that's quite common to many newcomers to Canada. I myself am an immigrant to this country. I came at the age of 12, and I settled in Mississauga at the age of 14. And, you know, due to some challenges that we experienced, my father actually left because he's a physician and he couldn't work as a physician here in Canada. And so my family ended up being broken. And so as a consequence, myself at the age of 14 and my brother at the age of 9 were being raised by a single mom in a completely new country. My mom didn't speak English at all at that time. And my mom had to clean people's houses at the time to really make ends meet and put food on our table. And why do I share that? Because I think probably everyone in this room knows somebody, either experienced this themselves or knows somebody that has gone through such a struggle of an immigrant family, of a single parent family. And going through all of that, my mom was able to raise two children, myself and my brother, put us through school, through education, and she ensured that we have personal responsibility, that we know how to save up for a rainy day, and that we're contributing members of society. And I think that's important. Personal responsibility is very important, and especially for women, because we have to fight hard for everything. And that's true for women in politics. And so when I first became interested in politics, when I graduated from my nursing degree and I started working as a nurse, there became an opportunity to run for the nomination in my riding of Mississauga Centre. And as some of you may know, nominations are really hard to fight. And I ran against the woman who ran for leadership of our party, Tanya Grenick-Allen. And at that time, I ended up losing the nomination. I was second. But even prior to that, many of my mentors told me, Natalia, you're not ready. You should walk before you run. It's not your time. And I told them, you know what? I live here. This is my community. I'm passionate about healthcare. I'm a nurse. I want to bring positive change to my community. I'm going to give it a shot. And as a young woman, so many people were discouraging me from going into politics, but I stuck to my gut, and I decided, no, this is for me, I'm going to give it a shot. And unfortunately, I lost the nomination. And you know what? Failure is part of growth. And failure is part of the success, is part of the journey to success. If we never fail, we actually don't know what our potential is. And so, I ended up becoming second. And lo and behold, the candidate, Tanya Grenick-Allen, was later disqualified. And because I was the second runner-up, which I had to fight hard for that second place, don't get me wrong, I became appointed as the candidate. And the rest is history. But even with that, after I became elected, rightfully elected, as a member for the beautiful riding of Mississauga Centre, you know, I struggled. Because people who look like me are not really associated with the political image. And even so, even more so 5 years ago, when I looked a lot younger, you know, politics, lots of gray hairs 5 years later. So when I would walk into a room for a meeting, people would say, well, who do you work for? Because society, we're just people, young women, are usually assistants to MPPs. They're not MPPs. And so I would say facetiously, I work for the people of Ontario. But those stereotypes are still true until today. You know, I was recently in Morocco for a conference, and it was actually for women parliamentarians from the Francophone space. And I was there with a delegation. I was leading the Ontario branch delegation. And there was a male MP from the federal parliament, and we said hello. And same thing, he said, oh, so who are you here to staff? You know, and so it's just funny. Some things maybe don't change, but we have to be the change we want to see in the world. And someone wise once said, if you can see me, you can be me. So, and that really resonated with me, because other young women, other women, and youth as well, see young parliamentarians in the parliament. They see us reflected in the Ontario population. And that's really, really, really important. Because if the parliament doesn't look like what the population of Ontario looks like, well then, how can we represent the voices of all people? And that's including the voices of women and youth. And so, today, so let's talk a little bit about women in politics. So today, in our Ontario parliament, we have about 29% women. So that's about 37 MPPs out of 124. I would venture to say we have some work to do. And I think the work to do is to encourage more women to run for politics. Doesn't matter from which party. I really don't care which party it is. I would venture to say that more women participating in politics will result in better policies for all. And so, how can we encourage more women to participate in politics? Well, get involved in grassroots, volunteer, donate. Yes, especially business people here, you can donate. And just show them the possible and encourage them. It truly takes a village. And we also have, and I'm really proud to say, in this election, we've elected MPP Charmaine Williams from Brampton Centre. And she's phenomenal for many reasons, but one of them is that she was the first black woman elected to Brampton Council, and now she is the first black woman in a PC cabinet. And so she famously said that she didn't like the term Minister of Women's Issues. Like, what is that, Minister of Women's Issues? Why do we even call that women's issues? And she actually changed the name of her ministry. And now the name of her ministry is the Ministry of Women's Social and Economic Opportunity. And I think that's really great. And it inspires a new generation of women. And she's just such a thrill to work with. And in fact, together, we're going to be talking to the speaker about establishing a parliamentary friendship group for women parliamentarians in our parliament, because we don't have one, and we should have one. And so, and the idea of establishing this parliamentary group is for all women from all parties to get together, to talk, and to elevate women's issues, or to talk about women's challenges in a nonpartisan way. And so I hope that next time when I come here, and hopefully maybe with Minister Charmaine Williams, we'll have this parliamentary friendship group established. So let's talk a little bit about the federal parliament. You know, in the federal parliament, we have 103 women out of 338 MPs. And so that's also about 30%. So I do think we can do better at the federal level as well. But our city of Mississauga is thriving with empowered women in council, including Her Worship, our mayor, Bonnie Crombie, and we have Councillor Chris Fonseca, Carolyn Parrish, Deepika DeMarla, and Sue McFadden. So we're really, really fortunate to have these incredible women leaders at the local level. Well, and I would be remiss not to mention Hurricane Hazel. And she was special in so many ways, not only because she was, you know, the longest serving mayor in Canada with 36 years of public service. You know, I'm only at 5 years. And those gray hairs are becoming more and more prominent. I don't know how she did it for 36 years, because public service does require commitment, dedication, but also sacrifice. The time that we spent away from our families, those are precious moments that we miss in our families. And so it is sacrifice, and it's not only sacrifice for the woman, but also for the whole family. And so 36 years, that's an incredible accomplishment. But also, you know, for a woman of a small stature, she really knew how to own a room, right? And she transformed our city. When Hazel began as a mayor of Streetsville, you know, Mississauga was a farmland. We had cows here. I didn't know that, right? I didn't live here back then, but it was a farmland. There were cows in Mississauga. And today, in large part due to Hazel's leadership, Mississauga is a thriving city, third largest city in Ontario, sixth largest city in Canada, thriving economic hub, one of the top 500 employers, multiculturalism. I mean, we speak over 100 languages in Mississauga. Isn't that incredible? And Hazel was a supporter of every single ethnic community out there, every single weekend, up until, you know, maybe December of 2022, you would see her in the community at all the celebrations, cultural, even religious celebrations, at the Ramadan, at the iftar dinners, at the Ukrainian Independence Day, Polish Independence Day. You would see her in the community. And that's what a true community leader does, makes themselves accessible to the community. And so we said goodbye to Hazel, but I think her legacy will live on forever. I mean, the Here Ontario LRT, it's going to carry her name. And so I think that's a great thing, because future generations will be able to learn about the legacy of Hurricane Hazel. And also, you know, she was a woman before her times. Even today, I struggle personally with being a woman in politics. But she somehow didn't let that bother her. She really knew what she stood for, she worked for it, and she didn't take no for an answer. And so I think that's something I can emanate as a woman in politics, or I want to emanate, and it's a model that we could all learn something from. And so I wanted to just highlight some of the incredible women that we have in our community in Mississauga. Carly Farrow, the president and CEO of Trillium Health Partners. So previously, she was the executive vice president of patient care services and chief operating officer, where she was accountable for clinical operations and the delivery of exceptional patient experiences. You know, it's great for a change to have a woman CEO in a hospital. And I think Mississauga is really good at having women leaders in different industries. So I'm glad to see that. And of course, our former CEO, Michelle D'Emmanuel, is now our Secretary of Cabinet for the Ford government. So that is also a huge accomplishment. And she has really helped our government steer the way through the pandemic. And so she's playing an instrumental role. And that is another Mississauga lady that we're very, very proud of. Kirsten Combs, she was already mentioned as the president of AstraZeneca Canada. She's a business leader with 25 years of experience, and she's leading the cardiovascular and metabolic disease franchise. And there are many, many more women in Mississauga who are leaders. But before I conclude, I just wanted to mention a few more remarkable women who are not from Canada, but who I think we can all learn something from. And these are brands. These are brands of leadership, but also of womanhood. So for example, Queen Elizabeth II. That was another incredible loss that we all suffered. I think we can all remember where we were when we learned of the loss of Queen Elizabeth II. She was the longest serving monarch. I don't know how many prime ministers she worked with, but she, I think, is the embodiment also of public service and of sacrifice. So we remember Queen Elizabeth II. Margaret Thatcher is another incredible example. Another woman ahead of her times. Iron Lady, saw Great Britain through the war, was not an easy task. Another favorite of mine is Marie Skłodowska-Curie, which you may not know her, but she was a scientist. She was Polish, but the French like to take her from us. I mean, she was married to a French guy, so, but her name was Marie Skłodowska-Curie, and she actually discovered radium and polonium. So she discovered two elements in the periodic table, and thanks to the radium, we are now able today to have X-rays. And so it's an incredible achievement, but one that we don't really hear about, right? That it's a woman that was responsible for the discovery of radium, thanks to which we have this incredible technology of X-rays. Malala Yousaf. I mean, I think that's a brand in itself. A women's rights activist, an education activist. She suffered, of course, and she received the Nobel Prize of Peace, rightfully deserved. And I think she's an icon for young women, and especially for women who live in countries where are not recognized. So those are some of the ladies that I really cherish and that I look up to for inspiration in my work as MPP. But also in the different roles that I carry. I was recently married about 2 years ago, and it's different. Once you're married, there are more responsibilities. And juggling them, I think those are some of the struggles that we as women have, juggling those many responsibilities and the many competing priorities. But I think we do such a great job at it. I think our male counterparts could learn something from us on that. So thank you so much. I hope you've learned something from my long discussion today. But it's truly an honor to be here today. To talk about women and how incredible we are. So thank you so much, and happy International Women's Day.
If you're interested in participating in this speaker spot every month during Good Morning Mississauga, contact us, contact Steph, and we have some spots available in April, I believe.
Yep.
All right? And it's 2 minutes. Great exposure. A room full of people like this today is awesome. So today I'd like to please welcome speaker, Adrian Fekete, sorry, Star Quality Private Investigations.
Thank you.
All right, there we go. Do you want to use this mic or that mic?
I can use that mic.
Okay,
that's
great.
Perfect. There you go. Going to wear my hat, but then I realized that Anthony and I would be twinning, so we're not going to do that. Good morning. When people think private investigator, they immediately think Pink Panther. They imagine a man lurking in the shadows with a long trench coat and a fedora. That was very yesterday. Good morning. My name is Adrienne Fegata, and I am the founder of Star Quality Private Investigations. Today, as we celebrate International Women's Day, I wanted to share a few quick stories. I've only got 2 minutes, so I'm going to be super quick. I would like to first off talk very quickly about the woman who inspired me growing up, which was my mom. She survived the Hungarian Revolution and immigrated to Canada. She had nothing but a backpack and zero English. She had faced extreme threats with courage and grace. So if you can imagine story time at my house, my friends were reading Cinderella. My mom, she was sharing stories of carrying hand grenades and Molotov cocktails and lots of other fun stories. But I realized growing up how important this messaging would be to me and how symbolic throughout my own journey of breaking barriers as a female. Sorry, I'm getting blinded by the light here. Because I always did what I loved regardless of gender. In high school, now I'm going to age myself, but the girls wanted to go into home ec, boys got shipped off to auto mechanics. I wanted to twist a wrench. That wasn't happening. I went down to my principal's office, and for 2 weeks, he just kept kicking me out, and he said, absolutely not. You're a girl. Girls don't take auto, which was confusing to me because I wanted a car. But anyway, I was the first female to take auto mechanics after, I think, 3.5 weeks of bugging, with many to follow. But after he allowed me in the class, he proceeded to tell me that I was not smart, that I would never amount to anything, that I should go marry rich, have a few kids, and I'd be fine. And while, you know, wanting to be a mother, being an entrepreneur was also extremely important to my future. So to this day, though, those words still fuel me, because for me, rejection truly is redirection. Today, I am the first woman in Canada to own a fully licensed private investigation and security business, and the female with the longest history in the private sector. As well, I'm a mother of four, and that's a whole nother story. It has taken a lot of courage to face obstacles like online threats, stalking, having cinder blocks thrown through the front window of your home as a sign of being rejected because of gender. I've always remained true to myself, and I've always listened to my gut, because the struggle is part of the story. And my three favorite words, yes, you can. Thank you.
Hey, everyone. So I knew this was going to happen, that the fact that we have such great stories happening today is all about Women's Day. So anything that I say, I don't know if it's really going to matter. But two important things that I wanted to take with you today. First is my name. My name is Eduardo, name of my company, Nova Idea. And I am what they call out there, your promo guy. So until they change this fact that I'm the only Eduardo at the MBOT, right?
Yes.
Only one. So until they hire or do whatever, bring a member with that name, think about me. Secondly, I provide promotional materials for companies like yours to help to connect your brand with your prospects and clients. So as long as we pass along these two things, I think we have a win today. I left on the table a package that we created exclusively for the MBOT members. This is our promo red package. What it means is that you're looking for a lot of savings for your company when it comes down to promotion materials. I'm not going to dwell much about it because I'm pretty nervous. I'm great in promoting other people's business. I'm horrible doing myself. So if you want to learn more about it, talk to me. We are getting a lot of requests about this package, and I want to make sure you take advantage of that. Again, Eduardo, promo guy, Nova Idea. Thank you.
Good morning, everyone. Happy International Women's Day. I don't always have the pleasure of having another Natalia in the room, so thank you. And I wanted to do a bit of a preamble and say, this is a very powerful day to talk. I realized, being in construction, I'm very grateful for the opportunities I get, and I also want to thank for the doors that get opened for you. And so I've partnered with my brother-in-law, Andrew, and we are the co-partners of Allaire Homes Lauren Park. A big part of construction is that we think it's about building a home, which is correct. That's the number one priority. However, we've realized that it's about taking the homeowner and really walking them through the process. It is a very emotional experience. So Allaire Homes Lauren Parks gives you the opportunity to plan your project and think about what it is that you want to do in your home. How do you want to celebrate your Christmases, Thanksgivings, and be able to understand your project so then you could take it into construction, have all the information you need, and be able to have the project managers tell you and show you what is possible. So Allaire Homes Lauren Park walks you through planning and the construction project, and in the end also taking you at the very end of the project and not just leaving you in your home, but giving you 2 years warranty to be able to settle in, find what works, what needs to be adjusted, and then be able to settle into your home and be able to celebrate. So with that, it's a big opportunity in residential construction to be able to go against the status quo and see what's possible in all these future builds in Mississauga. Thank you.
Thank you, Guy, and good morning. And Natalia, I am a former two-term member of parliament for Newmarket Aurora. So thank you for what you're doing. It is awesome to have young women in our parliament and carrying that torch. So thank you. Winston Churchill said, give me 3 days to write a one-hour speech. Give me 3 hours to write a one-hour speech, 3 days to write a 10-minute speech. So you know how much time it took to write a two-minute speech, but I wrote it. 8-year-old Emma wrote in her letter, I am so glad to be in school because I want to be somebody when I grow up. Licensed by Health Canada to procure, store, ship, and mobilize donated essential medicines to developing countries, Health Partners International Canada ensures that Emma in Ghana and Angela in Botswana and vulnerable people in more than 130 countries have health and hope to be somebody's. The generosity of the pharmaceutical industry in Canada, many of them located right here in Mississauga, is making an enormous difference around the world in every community where we work with our NGO partners. Through the outpouring of concern for the people of Ukraine and the generous contributions of Canadian pharma, Health Partners has mobilized in the last 12 months more than $25 million worth of medicines to Ukraine. And the need is now compounded by the tragedy created by the recent earthquakes in Turkey and Syria. And our hearts are truly broken for the people who have suffered so much loss. As the only charity licensed to manage medicines, we fill a very unique place in the not-for-profit arena, and our strength is our partnership with Canadian Pharma. Our reach into 130 countries impacts lives every day, and young ones like Emma can have health and healing and hope to be somebody when she grows up, maybe a member of parliament in Ghana. So we invite you to partner with us in this vital work. We need your help. Check out our website, hpicanada.ca. See my colleague, Diana Gomez, or myself after breakfast. Thank you so much.
Hey guys, I'll keep it quick. Just excuse me while I stumble over myself. I'm not much of a speaker. But I do want to take a quick moment just to thank MBOT so much for their support and the great work they do for the local business community. So my name is John Reeser again. I'm with Better Events Management Group. We are the makers of BizCon. And I just wanted to bring to your attention a super exciting event that we have coming up on March the 22nd at the Mississauga Convention Center. We're producing the 6th annual BizCon Business Expo and Conference. At this event, you will meet with over 70 businesses that are there exhibiting to feature business products and services to help support you in your business. And then above and beyond that, You'll be able to network with hundreds of like-minded business owners, executives, entrepreneurs, investors, and take in some really valuable seminars. We're bringing in a speaker from AdWorld. If you don't know what AdWorld is, it's like the world's largest advertisement and marketing conference. So we have an AdWorld speaker coming in. We're producing a great workshop on social media marketing, and that's going to be kind of free as part of the event as well. But as MBOT members, we'd like to extend to you complimentary admission to this event. So I've brought with me some tickets. There's some tickets as well at the welcome table, and I'll bring around some tickets to each table as well, which are regularly $40 at the door. But as you know, our friends here at MBOT, we'd absolutely love to offer you complimentary admission to the show. And lastly, you know, if anyone is interested in exhibiting, there's a couple spots left. And just come and see me, and I can help you out with that. But I just want to say thanks so much, and we look forward to seeing you guys on March 22nd at the Mississauga Convention Center. And for more info, you can check out bizcon.ca. Thank you.